Christopher Lee Watts unlawfully, feloniously, and knowingly caused the death of Bella Watts, a child who had not yet attained 12 years of age, and the defendant was in the position of trust with respect to the victim in violation.
The emotion there, that's Bella and Celeste's grandfather. You can see right there his heartache absolutely on full display. He lost his grandchildren, his daughter, in one horrible night. And in the last hour, Chris Watts was charged with first-degree murder of his pregnant wife and young daughters. There are still so many questions, especially why. We're at least getting some of the details on how the murders played out. According to the arrest affidavits, and I'll warn you, some of the details are pretty gruesome, maybe difficult to hear, but that's what investigators are dealing with. That's what a grandfather's dealing with. Monday, August 13th, a friend dropped Shanann home after a business trip. It's around 2 a.m. The friend says Shanann hadn't been feeling really well. Then around 5 a.m., Chris Watts tells police he told his wife he wanted to separate. So there was no yelling, but it was an emotional conversation. Then Chris leaves for work about a half hour later. 10 a.m., Shanann misses her doctor's appointment. Again, she's 15 weeks pregnant, and that alarmed her friend, who again had just dropped her off the night before. Her friend Nicole called police to check on Shanann. 2:25 that afternoon, police arrive at the Watts home. Shanann's purse, medication, cell phone still at the house. Upstairs, the detective sees the master bed had been stripped. The bedding was on the floor. He checks for foul play but doesn't find any signs. Chris tells the officer Shanann told him she was taking the girls to a friend's house. 7 a.m. the next day, August 14th, police learn Shanann and her two daughters did not come home. They issue a missing persons press release. Now let's take a closer look at the first few hours after Shanann came home. This is based solely on Chris Watts' confession as written in the same affidavit. So Chris tells Shanann that, again, he wants a separation, so he goes downstairs for a moment, then goes back upstairs. And on the baby monitor, he says that their daughter, Bella, who's 4 years old, is already, and I'm quoting here, sprawled out on their bed. She is blue, and that Shanann was actively strangling their other daughter, Celeste. Chris then says he was enraged and strangled Shanann to death. Chris Watts admits he drove all three bodies to an oil work site. He buried Shanann near two oil tanks and dumped his little girls inside the oil tanks. Now, a drone spotted a bed sheet near the field of the oil tank, and that sheet matched the pillowcase pattern that was found in the Watts home. Let's go back to our panel, HLN legal analyst and criminal defense attorney Joey Jackson with us, and psychotherapist and author Robi Ludwig is with us. She wrote the book, Till Death Do Us Part. Again, wow, Robi, you hear that, that account, and again, it's pretty tough to listen to. Do you see this as something that investigators are going to have to wrestle with, or is this a guy just trying to save himself here in the last hours?
No, this definitely sounds like a man who wants to save himself. And, you know, when we look at family annihilators, we don't know that much about them in general because they tend to either kill themselves or confess to the murder. And this is where Chris Watts is a little bit more different than your average family annihilator, in the sense that he really seems to just want to save himself, and that he'll lie as a way to get away with what he actually did. And where that is typical of the person who commits intimate partner homicide is they really consider their wife as the person who is getting in the way of them living the life that they deserve to live. So I think, like what Joey said earlier, you know, when you listen to this, it just doesn't make sense. His account of events don't sound logical. They don't really sound plausible. That's not the way a grieving father would act. You don't put your children in oil even after they're deceased, that it just, unless you're psychotic, which he doesn't sound to be. So I think what we're dealing with here is somebody who just wanted a do-over in life, and it's very, very dangerous. And what's interesting is that these family annihilators tend not to have a history of mental illness or have a criminal history either.
Let's, you know, we're looking at some of the pictures here, Robi, as you're speaking of this picture perfect family. And Joey, let's.
Yeah.
Okay, want to interrupt here. Now we're finding out that this is where the daughters were found, just to give everybody. So this is pertinent video, just to give everybody an idea of what investigators were up against. Number one, the rural area and the areas that they had to search. And this is specifically where we're found. So when we're talking about in oil and oil tanks and near oil tanks, It's pretty gruesome to think about that. This beautiful wife and two beautiful little daughters, and that is basically their burial site. So, wow, that's something investigators are dealing with. Let's hit that point, Joey, just on what investigators are up against when you're talking about either proving or disproving Chris Watts' story.
You know, interestingly, as you look at this, and this just, you know, it's hard to fathom. You can't even envision or imagine what the family is going through. But as we look at these pictures, Mike, what strikes me is that in addition to these pictures, if you delve into the story, you see these Facebook videos and, you know, my daddy's my hero, and you have this big reveal, and he's coming out of the kitchen, and they're like, oh, my wife's pregnant, and it just seems like everything's so picture perfect. I would think the defense will seize upon this in terms of establishing that he would never do such a thing, but it really just boggles the mind. So, I mean, in part of the investigation, obviously, Mike, is not only, you know, the fields that you were showing us, which are significant, where the bodies were recovered and the oil and the shallow burial as it relates to his wife, but it's the totality of it. It's this that we're looking at, these photos. It's the family unit. It's what he was doing. We understand also that there was some allegation of an affair, and it's shameful. And then he takes the bodies to this particular place. I think the question will be why. In the event that you have unclean hands and you were protecting your children and you really wanted to get back at your wife, even if you snap for one moment, after that, what do you do? Is this the way that you behave? And so I think the defense is certainly up against a lot in this case as the investigation unfolds and proceeds. But it's just, goodness, Mike, I mean, who doesn't look at these photos and just have the visceral reaction of just wanting to fall apart? Look at this gorgeous family that doesn't exist allegedly because of him. Are there not, and I guess Robi could speak to this, other ways out? Like, if you don't get along with your wife, how about a divorce? How about just leaving? How about just going your separate ways?
Yeah. All right. Guys, thanks again. Robi, Joey, sorry, Robi. We a couple other stories we want to get to, but guys, thanks again so much.